Right, welcome back to New Day. It's now time to look at, you know, the papers and pick, you know, three dominant stories or four and focus on this morning. The Business and Financial Times says health facilities risk closure for failure to register and no more arts universities. Those are the stories captured by the Business and Financial Times. The Finder newspaper says Cocoa Board workers to revolt, ICU issues warning. Power sector players in crucial meeting tomorrow, I believe today, over FPSO Kwame Nkrumah shuts down. How will that affect our energy? I believe that will be the critical thing they will be talking about. VRA owes Ghana Gas over $250 million. Akufo-Addo has no moral right to criticize governments, and that's from the General Secretary of the NDC, Johnson Esiedu Nketia. MPs alleged killer needs psychiatric examination. Defense counsel. The Ghanaian Times newspaper says airport extension begins. AG given 2 weeks to file response in Gitmo suit. NDC attacks Nana's address. Those are the stories captured by the Ghanaian Times newspaper. Water flows out and so on. That's on the back page. And Daily Guide newspaper says JB's killer not mad, says judge. And Rich Hospital bloated by $142 million. And that's the excerpt from the Akufo-Addo address, what he termed as real state of the nation address. So they are still continuing series of that in the Daily Guide newspaper. NDC jabs Akufo-Addo, also in the Daily Guide newspaper. The Daily Graphic newspaper says Woyomi asks for three years to refund money. Attempts to criminalize government projects by NPP fail. That's attributed to the NDC. Refer my client to psychiatric facility. Counsel for MP's killer pleads. And Mahama Turkish leader cuts short for Terminal 3 project at KIA. First ladies of Ghana, that's Ghana, Turkey, donate to four institutions. Also on the back page of the Daily Graphic. And my final paper for the morning, I actually cringed when I saw the word on the front page of the Herald newspaper. It says, Kwatirikwa Akufo-Addo exposed again. I mean, I just got this, you know, thing under my skin when I saw the headline there. And Financial Post is the final one, actually. It says, Accra Kumasi high-speed rail here. Digital money spread enters fast phase. And Turkey's Erdogan to visit Accra. He's already, I think last night I saw him wave to the president, so he's already out. Financial Post, you're late. Right, so those are the headlines for the morning. My guest, RC, said I have lawyer Yao Opon with us here this morning. Lawyer Yao Opon, good morning and good to see you back in the studio as well. And we have a very vocal, very articulate woman, a pharmacist by profession, also the second vice chair of CVP. Good morning to you and welcome, Madam Susan Edu Amankwa. Always a pleasure to have you join us in the studio. All right, so I actually wanted to, you know, start off with the Woyomi asks for money, but there was a conversation going on behind the scenes that was like, so a tale of two cities. So I would want her to read A Tale of Two Cities, and then, you know, just a minute or and a half, you know, and then we would get into that discussion of why we're talking about A Tale of Two Cities and two half truths. Go on.
Okay. So A Tale of Two Cities, it says, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom, it was the age of foolishness. It was the epoch of belief, it was the epoch of incredibility. It was the season of light, it was the season of darkness. It was the spring of hope, it was the winter of despair. We had everything before us, we had nothing before us. We're all going directly to heaven, we're all going directly the other way.
Okay. I mean, those are clues, big enough. I mean, try and guess. They are talking about, you know, two personalities. Of course, President John Dramani Mahama delivered the State of the Nation address. The presidential candidates of the New Patriotic Party did his own thing as well. And so that actually makes up the truth. I thought that was funny. I thought it was hilarious. But it brings to light exactly what the issues are. You know, far left, far right. There's never a middle ground for the two parties. All right. So that actually brings us to, you know, what the NDC did yesterday. The General Secretary, you know, had the opportunity to address the press on what they called, you know, falsehood peddled by the New Patriotic Party's Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo presidential candidates. First of all, let me pick your thoughts on, you know, the whole press conference and, of course, Johnson and Sadin can say was at his Larry's best.
I mean, like I said, a tale of two cities. Yes. The president comes up and says, this is the state of the nation. It's all light. It's all
rosy
and, you know, better days ahead, etc. And of course, the MPP comes and it's all doom and gloom and, you know, dark days and stuff like that. And really, there doesn't seem to be a middle ground. But life is not really about that. Life is about the extremes and the middle ground also. So in this population that we have of 26 million, there are definitely some people who will be feeling the better Ghana. And they definitely are people in this country who are not feeling the better Ghana. And then there's a middle ground of people who things are not too bad, things are not too good, and are there. What we want to know and what we will determine on 7th November is whether the tale being told by President Mahama is the actual tale of the majority of people or the tale being told us in, you know, Nana Akufo-Addo is what Ghanaians are feeling.
Okay. Regardless of what those two, you know, commentaries are, okay, what do you think the conversation really should be about?
Well, the conversation should be about how people view not just now, but the future. You know, what have we done now that bodes well for a good future? Or what have we done now that, will not bode well for posterity and our children's children? It should not just be about us and how we feel now, but we should be thinking, you know, 5, 10 years. Because the decisions that are going to affect 5, 10 years are the things that we do now.
Okay.
And that is how we should be thinking. So, you know, we should look at it and say, this government has taken certain decisions. They may be tough decisions, but are they being implemented in such a way that it is good for our future? Or are they being implemented in such a way that it doesn't bode well for our future?
Okay.
And base our decisions on that and vote and say that this is what we feel and this is and we are comfortable with and we are voting with our thumbs.
Okay. Lawyer, she raised, I mean, very interesting and valid points about is that posterity, because whatever decisions are taking are supposed to give birth to fruits for Ghanaians, not just present but the future generation. So the two leaders, whatever, I mean, President Mahama, he's the president of the republic, elected, right? Whatever tales they are telling, what do you think people, ordinary people, should be focusing on? I mean, she has talked about the fact we should look at future generation. What else matters to you?
Well, thank God I'm one of the ordinary people.
People. So what are you feeling, even before you answer me? What are you feeling?
Well, despondency. I mean, I'm just sad because in the first place, we have to look at this, the background or the foundation for this whole state of the nation. And when you go to
the principles behind that,
for example, Article 34(2) of the Constitution, the president shall report to Parliament at least once a year all the steps taken to ensure the realization of the policy objectives contained in this chapter, and in particular, the realization of basic human rights, a healthy economy, the right to work, the right to good health care, and the right to education.
Okay.
And so, based on this, and then also in Article 67 also says that the president shall report to Parliament on the general health of the economy and so on. And again, we know that all of us also have a duty to ensure that we shape the political views of people and disseminate information. That's in fact one of the fundamental functions of political parties.
Okay.
So even before I go on, I will expect that we get a middle way from my good friend's party, CPP.
Sure.
At least. So one side has presented to us what has been described quite rightly as the doom and gloom. Then another person also, everything is rosy. I think we have to also realize that now, at least, we are thankful to technology. Sure. All of us will know if we are being transformed or if our lives are getting worse.
Okay.
I mean, if you construct my road, no, I need no one to tell me that my road has been constructed. Okay. Because I would no more be hitting my car into potholes and manholes.
Okay.
And especially if development is one person at a time, then as far as that person is concerned, he needs no one else to still tell him that, can't you see that I have transformed your life? Again, if my road has been constructed, or my road is bad, I also don't need any other person to tell me that, can't you see that your road is bad? Okay. Can't you see that you don't have hospitals, you don't have proper facilities for education? So if they will take it that, as people will say, Ghanaians are discerning, then some of these truths and half-truths may not even matter, because we know ourselves. Mm-hmm. These are not things that should be in books. These are practical things that we feel and we live.
So what should it then have contained? Because you mentioned that he ought to mention, you know, what is the state? So yeah. If it's health, you know, if it's education, he's got to say what's been done.
Well, I think,
or yeah. Is it the manner he went about it that was wrong?
No, I think that both persons ought to realize that we know what they are talking about.
Okay.
And also that it takes humility to admit faults or problems that you have encountered and offer solutions. It also takes humility to also identify and recognize good deeds of others.
Okay.
So it may not be right, because, I mean, as somebody said, every one person who has benefited from something, there are 10 who haven't.
Sure.
And every 10 who haven't benefited, there may be another 20 who have also benefited from some other matter. So when they realize that we ourselves can recognize the good things or the bad things that have been done, then there may not be the need for the back and forth. And again, I'm especially consistent with my own belief in this whole governance system, sometimes tainted with falsehood. Let us leave this campaign to the individuals I am going to vote for, not parties. Mm-hmm. So if a presidential candidate states his opinion on a political matter, it should take another presidential candidate to come and tell us his views. And I think even before Nana Akufo-Addo finished, President Mahama has, whether he did it himself or has caused to be published, whatever, Facebook or social media, his own views about what Nana Akufo-Addo
said. Understand. And he said he was exercising his constitutional
rights. Because
rights.
I don't care about what a general secretary or a chairman of a party says. I'm not going to vote for him. I'm not going to vote for his party. My resources are not going to be vested in him to manage or mismanage. I must be given the opportunity to assess that individual.
But if it was in response to, yes, but if it's in response to the NPP's Nana Akufo-Addo,
because
because Nana Akufo-Addo did what he termed as the real state of the nation.
Forgive me,
correct?
I don't see what Nana Akufo-Addo said as being an NPP statement. It is Nana Akufo-Addo's own statement on the state of the nation. So also it was President Mahama's own statement, the way he personally experienced. It's a personal experience that he narrated to us. Yes, as president. And another person, as a citizen of Ghana, also thinks that this is my own personal experience. All of us have our own personal experience in the way the economy and the political environment has been managed. So we don't need, because the acrimony will be reduced if those armchair critics, albeit the so-called political parties, do not get into the fray. Let us assess these presidential candidates. I think almost all the parties now have their presidential candidates. I will ask candidate Mahama, not the president.
Edward Mahama.
Also come out and tell
candidates Green Street.
Yes,
they candidate.
Yes.
Okay, not yet. Yes. Dr. Bako Sindum, not yet. Not yet.
Maybe Ayarega.
Ayarega. Yes.
Okay.
It makes a lot of sense. No, so it was a needless.
Yes. So for me, because otherwise they would just cloud everything.
So was it needless?
No.
The two are not, but I think that the third one was just a gloss.
Okay.
And so I'm saying that they should just offer, because the demeanor of the person is as important as even what he says. And I want to see the person I'm going to vote for speak to me directly, so that I can hold him responsible. I cannot hold NDC or MPP responsible for telling me they will do one thing and doing a different thing, because they will not even be the
person. But people know they represent a party. That's also important.
That is not, for me, I mean, wrong or right, I'm saying that my understanding of the law does not tell me that NDC rules and MPP rules.
Right.
Otherwise, why would people say that okay, NDC has had 8 years. All right, and the constitution says you can only have 8 years.
So why?
Yes, when there is liability,
thank you.
They say, "Oh, I'm only 4 years." So, but when there is benefit, then they extend it. Let us just get direct statement from the people we are going to vote for. Already, they have limited it by choosing their own representative for us to choose one from to become president.
All right,
so we don't need them to come and tell us why they voted for this one or that one. It is not our chance to assess them one by one by they speaking to us directly, so we can hold them.
Well, thank you very much. Was it a needless press conference for the NDC to also respond to, you know, what they call attacks on President
Johnson? Oh, well, I mean, hey, there's freedom of speech. People want to get up and spend some money doing a press conference. Why not? I mean, it, and people will listen. Sure. And you see, and some of these things, this is why I want to disagree a little bit with Loyal Pong.
No problem.
You know, you see, sometimes some of the decisions these people take is influenced by the party.
Sure.
You know, so as much as we want to hold that individual responsible. Yeah, ultimately, the responsibility comes to them and the buck stops with them. But, you know, they have these party influence. The political party culture is a little tough, you know, and sometimes you give in to certain pressures. So respond. Why are you quiet? Respond. And then you may go against your better judgment and respond.
Sure.
So, you know, as much as I want us, yes, and I agree, take the policies that this individual is mouthing and assess that individual and say, okay, you, this particular person, these policies that you are mouthing, do they come out of a conviction that this is the way this country should go, or it's just convenience and you're mouthing it and you don't believe it? I always say, look, if you have a man and he comes to you and he says, I'm for gender equality, I'm for gender rights and things like that, and he's beating his wife and he doesn't allow his daughter to go to school, really, that man, whatever he comes to say out there to get votes, it's at variance with his personal life.
On rare occasions.
But you understand, I mean, he comes and he says all the nice things, but in his personal life, he is not living the things that he's saying. Then obviously, you know, so in voting for people, we must also assess them that way. Yeah. Too many times, and I've said this ad nauseum, we vote for any monkey in a suit because this is the party we like. Mm-hmm. And so we don't assess that person.
Individual.
And then we go and then we vote for the person. And that is why we have some parliamentarians who ought not to have been in parliament. Because the area in which they are, just because in this area we vote NDC, or in this area we vote MPP, or in this area we vote CPP, you just dress the monkey up and put him there, and they will go and vote for him. You get it? They don't make an assessment of that person. And then in the end, they are disappointed time and time again, but they keep repeating the mistakes because they vote as a party.
Yes, because
and we vote for this party.
Of course.
And sometimes they don't even know what the party actually stands for and what the party the things the party is articulating, whether it's they are policies of convenience or policies of conviction. You get it.
But that's so, I mean, lawyer point, I mean, to buttress the point you're making, because general secretary, very influential persons in a party, party chairman, very influential persons. I mean, in terms of even raising funds, organizing rallies, and those are capital intensive. So you really cannot disassociate, you can't delink them. It's one into whether you like it or not, you're voting for a person, you're voting for a party.
But you see, general secretaries, yes, powerful people in the party, you understand. I don't know whether they are just as powerful in the government, because you may have a president who decides that, look, you are a general secretary in your party, but I'm taking certain decisions, and this is my legacy. I want to become the president. Yeah, but you see, at any point in time in this country, we have a president and we have a general secretary of that president. Sure. You get it. So the character and the strength of character of that person also says it, because the party will come at you. And look, some of the things that we suffer in this country is because of the political party culture. Because this is the one that encourages patronage, is the one that encourages a certain level of graft and all those things. Yeah, and corruption. You know, and we cannot run away from that.
Okay.
You understand? So the strength of character of that person is important.
Okay.
So that when the party is coming at him with things that have to do with just the party and not with the nation as a whole, that person should be able to put his foot down and say, no, this is the way I'm going. So I agree. We need to assess the individuals. We need to assess the policies that they are coming out with and say, these policies that are coming out, how do they benefit us and our children and our children's children? Look, the America that we see today that is great, the foundations were not laid by the Obamas of this world. Mm-hmm. They were laid by the George Washingtons and the Abraham Lincolns. Mm-hmm. You understand?
Sure.
The things that they put ahead because they looked, 200 years ahead of them and say, in a certain way, this is the way we will go and this is the vision that we see. We want to see visionaries in this country.
Yeah.
People who are not just looking at today and what is it, but things that are looking and we can see them bear fruit, you know, in those things. But we must also feel as if we belong.
Okay.
Too many times in this country, there's no sense of belonging. It's me and my party and we've come and this is us and this is what we are coming to.
Winner takes all.
Without a sense of belonging, no party is going to achieve the things that they want to achieve unless they make other people feel as if they belong and all of us need to put our shoulders to the wheel. But I agree. A tale of two cities.
I just want to take the argument out of this. I won't take the argument out of it. I mean, the discussion out of this and talk about, you know, skirt and blouse voting and with what is happening in the U.S. where you have Congress controlled by the Republicans and Obama really struggles to push through. I mean, with the death of Scalia, he's struggling too because they want somebody who is a conservative and can represent. They haven't hidden their interest on blocking Obama. But if you bring it here, they tell you skirt and blouse voting would even cripple the government. And all, at the same time, when you flip it, it's even more dangerous for governance.
I tell you what, that has been one long prayer.
Oh, you want skirt and blouse?
I've been asking God to grant for me.
Okay.
And he may even decide not to grant any other prayer
mine.
Because that is the only instance where we will see real accountability and probity. Even though Parliament knows that they are not part of the executive and therefore not part of the government, everything they do point to the fact that they are not able to accept this fact.
Okay.
You understand? So let us then make it possible for them to accept the fact that there should be a president who is related to the party or the so-called minority, the people with the less number than the so-called majority. In other words, a president whose members or the related members in parliament have less number than the so-called opposition. In other words, you have a president who has to go to parliament and convince them, not because there are large numbers of people who also were sponsored by the same political party. I won't say they are members of the political party.
Sure.
They were sponsored by the same political party. That is when parliament itself become highly assertive for our benefit. Mm-hmm. As it stands now, with all due respect, I don't see the nature.
Because now parliament is like protocol. Oh, let's just
Because of the misunderstanding or what I call a falsehood that has gained currency and is becoming the truth. Parliament is now being governed as if we are in the UK. In the UK, you cannot form government unless you are a member of parliament, leader of the party that has majority. Before you, and you continue to hold the three positions, a member of parliament, the government, and also the leader of the party. You have to be in parliament, and you have to also be with the executive. We don't have that here.
But skirt and blouse voting itself, I mean, we saw that in the 2012 elections. I think in a place like
it never happened.
Yeah.
But
I think Mike Hammer's constituency, for instance, I think the NDC lost there, but President John Mahama won.
Oh, but
there.
A number of them,
a number
even
of
with
other
it, except
places,
that it doesn't.
I didn't see it did happen.
Cumulatively.
Doesn't happen.
Yeah, yes. But 2008, it nearly happened. And I pray that in the shortest possible time, God should just grant this one prayer for me.
It's a prayer that I'm sure there are many guys.
Skirt and blouse.
It's not a matter of skirt and blouse, but I agree with. I want a hung parliament. I want a parliament where the majority are the minority. You understand what
I mean? I understand.
Yes,
perfectly.
In terms of, you have CPP parliamentarians, yeah. You have MPP parliamentarians, you have NDC parliamentarians, you have PPP parliamentarians, all sorts of parliamentarians. The president may be a CPP president,
yeah. Yeah.
But the majority of the parliamentarians there are from the different parties. So he doesn't have his CPP as a majority,
yeah. Okay.
and because of that, he needs to make sure that he is talking across party lines, and that he puts the country first.
Okay.
Because he needs to convince all these different people who make up the majority, you know, that this is the way to go. And then that also, in some way, may limit him in the number of people that he'll be picking from his party to be ministers.
Okay.
So you get it. Otherwise, then everybody's out of. If he wants his parliamentarians to be there, and he picks all 50% from there, then they are virtually finished.
Right. You understand? What happened on the day president gave the address? I mean, dignitaries are there. The whole world are watching. And we turn parliament into some kind of a playground or a jamala.
All right, we'll have to move on the discussion now to the biggest story carried by the Daily Graphic, and it says here that Inoueme asks for 3 years to refund money. And I think the judge was ire in this. This is what the judge, you know, said. It says, the Supreme Court yesterday
questioned the
embattled businessman, Alfred Agbisi-Oweyemi, to take the court seriously after it dismissed his latest application seeking a stay of execution to allow him to pay the 51.2 million cedis he fraudulently received. Okay. And he's asking for 3 years, and I think he said that he wants to pay at the end of April. He wants to pay about eight million cedis. Mm-hmm. You can start off the conversation for us as lawyer.
And
why do you think the judge felt the need to tell him? I mean, are you taking us serious? What do you think happened?
I can see that because I'm aware that the application was dismissed.
Sure, it was.
I mean, that application had been filed some time ago. That was just before the time the period he himself had set to pay the entire debt,
sure.
That is by the end of September,
sure.
December last year.
Okay.
Then he filed another application to withdraw that application. And somebody else also, who is now described as a busybody, also came in and said that the Supreme Court didn't even have jurisdiction to ask Woyomi to pay.
Yes, he counted.
And then that was also dismissed. Now, then yesterday's application was for the application to withdraw the earlier application to pay by. And the court said, no, I think you should take it serious. You cannot abuse the court processes.
Sure.
You have an order of the court compelling you to pay an amount of money. You have to pay. Generally and ordinarily, the courts grant such applications. There's no doubt about that.
Okay.
If you have shown good faith. If, for example, he went to the court with a receipt that, my lord, I have paid, let's say, the 8 million he's even talking about. I have already paid the 8 million into court. Can you just be kind enough to give me the opportunity to pay the subsequent or the outstanding debt by this installment? Then the court can say that maybe 3 years will be too much. We want you to pay it within a year. But because of your previous conduct and not dispelling that with the payment of even the first installment, generally the courts will refuse such an application. And I may not be surprised if he does this. This is a gratuitous advice. If he does this and then go back to the court, perhaps the court may see the good faith that he has exhibited and may give him some respite, maybe not three years, but 2 years or 1 year. But I will say this, that if this case was handled by a private lawyer,
we would have seen an end.
As rapacious for money as your opponent can be, I'm telling you, all these monies would have been collected. And even if I'm offered 1%, if they like.
So you think the state has an interest as to why we're dragging or as to why it's delayed?
First of all, this case was commenced and completed by an individual.
Sure.
But because of their nature, it has to take the attorney. But there will be nothing wrong with the attorney general outsourcing the recovery of this amount to even a private lawyer. If the state systems, I should put it that, have some inhibitions in the way they should recover such money. Okay. And let me tell you, if the state was collecting it from other people, perhaps they may have done that by now. Mm-hmm. I'm saying that the lawyers in this country know people who can vigorously recover this money.
Okay.
And the procedure is clear. It's not just about going to pay money. The person has properties, seize those properties. The state can even take over, sell these properties, because as far as I'm concerned, this is almost like the proceeds of a crime.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Mm-hmm.
It's almost like the proceeds of a crime.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right.
But that aside, the normal processes for execution are well known. You can pay the property, auction it, can sell it as minimal a price as possible, if that is what the valuation clearly states, and then we move on. But if we have to wait for all of it to be collected at the same time, we may never get anything out
okay,
of it.
All right. Susan, I'll get your initial comments, and also more so when, you know, the quotes, real state of the nation, and then I practically talked about how government is unable to retrieve the Woyomi money and the like, if this gives them any reassurance that they're still working on it.
Well, I mean, you know, when I first heard it,
yeah,
the first thing I said, I was like, this guy's toying with us, he's a joker. You
see,
know.
Well, yeah, no, we rather.
I mean, oh, yeah, okay, we are the jokers. Yeah, I mean,
state institution.
You know, because, I mean, I just heard the first thing that came to mind, I was like, what? He's playing with us.
Yeah.
You know, he's just toying. He wants to pay over 3 years. He was supposed to have paid in December, like, yeah. Right? And, you know, and the
we are not even asking him to pay interest.
No, at all. Can you imagine that if you had gone to the bank for something like that and it had just sat down and done nothing, the interest that would have
such an amount,
you know, and look, we are paying him this money, which has lost value.
Yeah.
You understand? Because at that time, it was an equivalent of almost $40 million.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what is $51 million now?
Mm.
You understand? So you go and then you fraudulently get this money. You do all sorts of businesses with it. You make money and sit there and then come and says, okay, then I'll pay you as and when I like. Really? I mean, this is a joke.
But that's when they say the wheels of justice.
No, but
quickly, yes, I'm sorry. You see, the other side is that I think that sometimes I even feel that Woyomi shouldn't pay the money, to show a deterrence to the state itself. I mean, the state of Ghana, with all the awesome powers that the state has, will always be lamenting that Smarties came to deceive us, Woyomi came to deceive us, the Asuntaba, whatever, buy, and all these things. It is shameful.
No, but
we should sit down.
If you think that they deceived us, or it was deliberately done, and that the state
has... Against all the state apparatus.
Well, I mean, you know, because... Why is this happening with all the state apparatus and the power that it has to retrieve this money? Why is this happening? Why did somebody pay a Smarties that kind of money? Unless it was deliberately done. And all these funny things that you go on just lends credence to that. You get it. And perception is important. So if the perception is that, look, there are people in government who will let other people explore loopholes in the system so that they can benefit and they will get their kickbacks, who would do it? Look, if Woyomi had gone to steal plantain or goats, we would be having this conversation.
Don't go so far away.
So we are saying that white collar crime pays.
Yeah.
You understand? And it is okay. And anybody, any civil servant, anybody public servant sitting in a place who feels that I can do this and get away with it, I will not even serve jail time.
Of course.
You got and
there
get away
incentive.
With it. And this is no disincentive for criminals.
No.
Okay.
It is for clever people to do. But look, I look at it and I'm looking at the lawyer.
Yeah.
And his lawyer goes to say something about going to ICC.
Okay.
And he hasn't
yes.
even seen the letter.
Yes.
And he goes to court with it.
Yeah.
I mean, what kind of due diligence does this lawyer do that says, my client said it, so I have come to say it? even just by looking at him saying that, you know, the court burst into laughter when he read that the date of the first payment will be April 31. Goodness.